I'll stand, and he's going to read and read with him the call to worship today.
Good morning. I'm going to have you guys stand. We're going to be reading from Luke chapter 6, verses 37 and 38. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. know, guys, as we, I'm sorry, Pastor. As we come to communion, communion in my mind is a representation of letting go of everything that we hold on to. And it's our chance that we take the body of Christ into our heart and our soul, and the blood cleanses us. Everything that we hold on to, everything that's heavy on our hearts. And you know, no matter what, God chases us every time. No matter who is heavy on your heart, God's going to chase them.
Amen.
And God's going to prevail. And God, we can't give up. So when we're doing communion today, don't forget, God loves us more than anything. And God will win. Don't lose faith.
Please be seated for now. I'm going to go to the communion ritual. The Lord's Supper in our church is not limited to members of this local church. It's anyone who has a relationship with Lord Jesus Christ and believes in what he did for you on the cross. You're welcome to join us as we take the Lord's Supper. And the way that we do it is we walk the center aisles and take it. The two pastors, Pastor Sabino and Pastor Dave, will be here. And you can take the bread and the cup and go to your seat, and then we'll all take it together. Here's the invitation. You who truly and earnestly repent of your sins, who live in love and peace with your neighbors, and who intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort. Humbly kneeling, make your honest confession to Almighty God. And here's the confession that I will make on our behalf as I pray. We do not come to this your table, O merciful Lord, with self-confidence and pride, trusting in our own righteousness, but we trust in your great and many mercies. We are not worthy to gather the crumbs from under your table, but you, O Lord, are unchanging in your mercy, and your nature is love. Grant us, therefore, God of mercy, God of grace, so to eat at this your table, that we may receive in spirit and in truth the body of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and the merits of his shed blood, so that we may live and grow in his likeness, and being washed and cleansed through his most precious blood, we may evermore live in him and he in us. Amen. Now I'd like for us to say together the Lord's Prayer together. You can say this with me. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In the night that he was betrayed, Jesus, celebrating the Passover meal, first took the bread, and after he broke it, he gave thanks and said, "This is my body, which was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And that same night, he took the cup, and he shared it with the disciples, and he said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So I'd ask the pastors to come up right now, and as the music plays, we'll ask for you to line up in the middle aisle here and go out to the side aisles, and you'll receive the bread and the cup.
Always heaven.
Preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Take and eat this, remembering that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Remain standing, and the worship team is going to come up and lead us in a song. This is our prayer song, so altar, if you want to kneel at the altar, if you have a concern or a thanksgiving, you're welcome to come during this time and kneel at the altar, and after the song, we'll be led in prayer by Ramon Godoy.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. we get going on prayer. The leadership of any organization, the leadership at work, the leadership at church, we should always be praying for them. But when it comes to spiritual, the enemy doesn't like it when things are going well, and it will attack. And I'm not just talking about church here. I'm talking about home as well. The men and women in our homes. The parents, they're attacked spiritually as well. Deeply. Because if it can destroy the head of the home, it will destroy the family. When things are going well, when things are going really good, that's when we should be praying even more. Because the enemy is waiting for an opportunity to attack. And I'm not just talking to the husbands or the wives or so on. I'm also talking to the children. For you young people to be praying for your parents. And for us as parents to always be praying for our children. At all times. There's a great attack. I don't know if you know this or not, but there's a great attack happening within this church right now. And let me tell you, it is because God is getting ready to move within this church. And we should be praying. God is going to do a lot of miracles within this church. And we should be ready to receive it. And I want to share this with you in Isaiah 41, verse 10. This is out of the New King James Version. He says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed." And I found this so powerful right here, and it touched my heart. "For I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." He will never leave us. We are the ones who walk away from him. He walks in a straight line. We are the ones that take the deep. We're not perfect, and we will never be perfect. And sometimes I feel like Paul says, "I am the greatest sinner of them all. I am not worthy to be up here." But I thank the Lord for his love and his mercy. Thank God for him giving us the opportunity to be together and praise and worship him together. Not just by saying the the Hispanic church came together, so no, by brothers and sisters in the Lord coming together, in whatever language it might be. One spirit is the most important. Please join me in prayer. My Lord, dear Heavenly Father, we do come together here as brothers and sisters in one spirit, Father. It says in your glorious word, as I just read, Father, for I am your God. Yes, you are. A lot of heavy hearts, my Lord. A lot of pain. Have your spirit move within each one of us and within our church. Touch us, Father. Touch our children. God, let your spirit move. You know our needs. You know what we're going through. As David said unto you, hear my cry. Hear our cry, my Lord. God, and I just thank you, Father, for giving me life today to come and worship you and glorify you and move within each one of us and put a hedge of protection upon our families, our loved ones. God, and I just want to say once again, thank you for the opportunity to love and praise and worship you, God. You are the Almighty. We don't deserve you, but yet you have so much love and mercy for us. And you always accept us with open arms. And I just thank you, Father. And I pray for our pastors, our leaders, of our church, of our country, of the world. I ask that your spirit touch them, my Lord. Whether they do know you or not, as a personal Savior, I ask that you touch them. You minister to them, my Lord. God, we just lift every single one of us here unto you. And thank you for being our God. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Led by the Spirit and help us to in leading worship and talking and so forth. And I asked Ramon to do prayer, and when I was asking him to do the prayer, I thought, well, you know, Ramon, if you want to say a few words, you can do that. But I didn't say anything. The thought crossed my mind. And I believe that was really what you said, Ramon, was, where'd he go? He's over here somewhere. Was really of the Lord. And so our church is in the beginning stages of a type of revival, but also there's spiritual opposition going on too. And So let's be open to what the Lord has for each one of us. And God sometimes uses the littlest things to bring the biggest blessings, and He uses our children too. So we're going to do a kids' message now. Tommy, who's your friend? Why don't you introduce her to you? Hey, you can introduce yourself. Tell them about yourself.
Thank you, Tommy. Hello, everyone. My name is Jane. And there's a word in my name that we don't use, but I just like to ask. Oh, yeah, I love the children. I just love children. Oh, I haven't told about you. You are a good boy.
Have you been in church here? I don't think you've been in church here before. I just invited you. Have you been in church before?
Well, I did once, but I stopped going.
Why did you stop going to church?
My daddy always said that churches always talk about money and money and giving.
Well, they do sometimes. We talk about a lot of other things around here. But you know, if you preach the Word of God, you're going to talk about stewardship.
Stewardship? What is that? People eating lots of stew?
Well, we do sometimes eat some chili when we have Western days and eat stew. But that's not what stewardship means. It doesn't mean eating stew. It means that everything we have belongs to God. We're stewards, managers of what everything God has given us. Everything belongs to God.
Everything?
Everything.
Including my mangoes?
Your mangoes?
Yeah, my whole crate of mangoes.
Oh, you're talking about the verse that says, give your first fruits.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't mean real fruits.
Oh, then what does it mean?
Well, even though God owns everything, you don't have to give everything in the offering to God. You give a tenth, the first fruits. And it's not fruit, it's just what God gives you, you give back a tenth, a portion. That's the rule of thumb that's in the Bible, the tithe.
Oh, the tithe. Got it.
See, I do that.
You do?
Yeah. Pastor Brock, I do work around the house and I get an allowance. How many of you get an allowance? Or get money from your parents for working around the house?
Well, grandma,
your grandma and grandpa, okay. Or you get something. Is it, you get one? No? Whoa! Do you work around the house, kids? We got some cheap parents out there. You guys are working for free. You know what that is? Slavery. No, not really. If you're in the family, you have to work. Everybody has to work, right? Well, you might get $100 when you do 100 things. Oh,
100?
Oh my!
I only get $1, but I give a dime in the offering. That's the tithe. That's the first fruits. Hey, I got an idea.
Hmm?
Thank you. You came up with a great idea. How about you give me $100 for allowance? That sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Yeah. Then I can give $10 in the offering. Yeah. Okay, right now, you get $1 a week, and it's for doing what? Let's see. I help with the dishes sometimes. Okay, so if I give you $100, that means you're going to have to do 100 times more work. Whoa. Never mind. Let's keep it at $1. Okay. Hey, kids. You need to talk to your parents about working really hard and getting an allowance, okay? You did? Okay, and then if you get a dollar, you got to put a tenth in the offering, okay? That's the tithe. That's what the Bible says, okay? Do you know how to figure out what a tenth is? Well, you guys need to go to math class, too. Okay, all right. Do you understand that? You can give to God. Your parents could give you some offering to give to God, too, right? That'd be good. But if you do get an allowance, you might have to do extra work. So think about whether you want to do extra work and get an allowance or just keep doing what you're doing right now. Okay? All right. Hey, I'm sure glad you came to church today because you helped with the kids' message.
Sure. I'll be glad to come back anytime you like.
Okay. Thank you, kids. You can go to kids' church now.
All right. Bye-bye, youngins.
Thank you, Evangelina.
I've been thinking about the spirit of giving. Normally, that's kind of a Christmas thing. We think about giving at Christmas time. We give gifts to each other. But I've been thinking about the idea that there is a spirit of giving. And I think of examples of people who had a spirit of giving. I've mentioned this before, but some of you haven't heard the story. There was a family in my church when I first started out pastoring. We planted a church in Wichita, Kansas. Their names were the Crowleys. And they had an El Camino. Anybody know what an El Camino is? It's kind of like a car pickup truck kind of thing. And in the back of it, it was always full of stinky beer cans. And I said to the Crowleys, I said, do you guys drink a lot of beer? He said, no. I said, why is your back of your El Camino full of stinky beer cans? I had to walk by it every time I went to church because they parked right by where I parked. And they go, well, and in Wichita, softball was huge. There was 10,000 people playing softball every Saturday night. Then we go around to all the softball fields and we collect all the cans and we turn them in. I said, what do you do with that? They said, we give the money to missions. So here they were on a fixed income. They were very poor, actually. Well, not very poor, but they didn't have a lot of money anyway. And they gave hundreds of dollars to missions because they collected all the beer cans and turned them in and got the money. And I think that indicates a spirit of giving. Another one that had the spirit of giving is a story that you've read in the Bible. It's a beautiful story. I'm just going to read it. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts. But a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, truly, I tell you, this poor widow has put more in the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. That's a spirit of giving. Another example of a spirit of giving in the Bible is a whole church that had a spirit of giving. It's called the Church of Philippi. I'm going to read from a scripture that Paul says concerning their giving in Philippians chapter 4, verses 14 through 20. He was in prison, and back in the Roman prisons, if you were going to eat, people that you knew had to bring food and so forth to you, otherwise you might starve. So they were dependent in prison on people bringing them food. In fact, a lot of times they were under house arrest and they couldn't work or do anything, and people would bring food and provisions to the house. Well, the Philippians knew that Paul was in a rough situation. He was in prison for preaching the gospel, and so they sent money to help him. And this is what he says about them. He says, nevertheless, you have done well that you shared in my distress. He was distressed. Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. Not that I seek a gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full.
having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. And then he says this, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. So not only can individuals have a spirit of generosity, but churches can have a spirit of generosity. So I was asking myself, well, where does that come from? Well, one place it doesn't come from, the spirit of generosity does not come from having a lot of money. Or let's say that you're generous with your time and your abilities. It doesn't come from having a lot of talent. Or let's say that you give a lot of time. It doesn't come from having a lot of time. In fact, it's kind of interesting, but studies on giving indicate that the more money you have, the less likely you are to give your money. The less percentage of your money you're going to give. And we hear stories, like I heard of Bill Gates giving, I think it was maybe $50 or $60 million to the University of Washington. But Bill Gates is worth, what, $100
billion?
No, he's not worth a trillion, $101 billion. Yeah, around $100 billion, right? So what percentage is that, you know? It's almost nothing. And I remember there was a movie star that gave $20,000 to an organization that helps animals. And I thought, wow, that sounds like a lot. And they made headlines and everything. $20,000. And then I looked online to find out how much she made a year. This movie star makes $20 to $30 million a year, and $20,000 was like less than 1%. So she's not even tithing. Yet she's making headlines. So the studies indicate that the more money you make, the lower percentage of your money you actually give. I mean, and that's not true of everybody, but it's true in general of people. So it isn't having a lot of money that makes you have a spirit of generosity. Now, on the other hand, it doesn't come from devaluing money, totally devaluing money either. The Bible teaches stewardship. We value money, and so we use it carefully. And sometimes families that have been raised in a very toxic home have no sense of the value of money. I knew a kid who just gave away his money if he'd make it, as soon as he would make it. And he made about $1,500 one summer working, and within a week it was all gone. And I asked that kid, I said, why didn't you spend all your money that you spent all summer working? You spent it in 1 week. And he said, I've learned in the home that I grew up in that if you don't spend your money, someone else will take it and spend it for you. He grew up in a home where his mother was hooked on heroin. And so having a spirit of generosity, it doesn't come from totally devaluing money, because stewardship means, and the idea of stewardship in the Bible means that money can do things, it's important, so we need to be careful how we use it. So where does the spirit of giving come from, and how can we develop? It's quite surprising, but the Bible says that one of the places that the spirit of generosity comes from, the spirit of giving, is a spirit of forgiveness. Now, it's interesting that forgiveness has give right in the middle of it, doesn't it? And that's that scripture we read for the call to worship. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. And that's often that scripture is used to, and it's taken out of context, it's used to say, well, if you give money to God, you'll get more back. I've had some pastors even say that. Well, it doesn't exclude that, but this concept, this principle here is much bigger than just money. First of all, the context is forgiveness. If you want to be a forgiven person, you need to forgive. You first accept what Jesus did to you. He modeled it. He forgave all of us. And then the response the overwhelming response, as we sang a little while later, that reckless love of God, the response to the reckless love of God is to recklessly forgive other people. I don't really think it means reckless. It means just incredibly extravagant forgiveness. Forgiving. So, having a generous spirit comes from realizing, first of all, what God has done for you. Forgiving you, what He's done for you. And then turning right around and forgiving other people. And if you give other people love, you tend to get love back. If you give other people forgiveness, you tend to get forgiveness back. If you give of your income and your money, you tend to get money back. It's a principle. But it's a bigger principle. It's not just a money principle. It's about having a giving spirit. So how can you develop a giving spirit? Well, one way would be to forgive someone. Open up. Something that you've been holding on to for a long time, forgive them. Leave it behind. Okay, secondly, the spirit of generosity comes out of trust. You trust in God and not in yourself or your own wealth. There's lots of scriptures that talk about that. But there's one that talks about first fruits. That's in Proverbs chapter 3. It says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops, then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. How is that about trust? It really is. Why does God ask for the first fruits? Because God does not deserve leftovers. He deserves our very, very best. If you have enough money to live on, then after I've paid all my other bills, if I have anything left, I'm going to give that to God. The primary issue right there is trust. You're going to make sure everything's taken care of, and then you're going to trust God. Why first fruits? When they first received the harvest, the first thing they gave was to God. They had to give that to God, and they trust. Not only they saw the harvest, so maybe it didn't take that much trust to give something. It was based off the increase, but they gave that to God, and then they trusted God to give them what they needed for the rest of the year. It's about trust. So a spirit of giving comes out of a spirit of trust in God. Now, what is the hardest thing for you to give? If you're very, very wealthy, writing a check for $20,000 would not be that big of a deal. It wouldn't be that hard for you to do. But maybe you're a businessman and you're busy all the time. That's how you earn that much money, and giving some time to show up in church to worship God. You just don't have time for that. Or let's say that someone has hurt you deeply, and the hardest thing for you to give is forgiveness. You'll do everything else, but you're not going to forgive that. Your family or your spouse or somebody. What about if the most valuable thing in the whole world is your son or your daughter? And they have a terrible illness. And you're doing everything you possibly can to get them better. Can you give your child's future, your child, into the hands of God? Whatever is the most difficult thing for you to give is the thing you need to give to God. And it's different from different people. So a spirit of forgiveness of giving comes out of trust in God. A spirit of giving, a spirit of generosity comes out of joy. Giving does not come from duty or a sense of guilt from joy, but from joy. And I remember reading about the Old Testament when they were raising money for the temple. People brought so much stuff. It was so joyful that they had to tell them not to give anymore. But there's a scripture that a couple of scriptures that talk about this, but I'm going to read one in particular. It's in 2 Corinthians 9:7. Each of you should give what you decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, I want to tell you that your motivation for giving is more important than the gift. Okay? Your motivation. in God's eyes, because God looks at the heart. You know, sometimes we do things out of guilt or shame. And there are actually cultures that sociologists and missionaries call shame cultures. Shame is a huge, huge part of their culture. And so a lot of the motivation for doing things in that culture results over whether you're going to save face or not, or whether you're going to be shamed or not. And different cultures are like that. And even within each culture, there are some things that are looked on with shame and some things that are not looked on with shame. And we tend to, right now in America, we tend to really focus hard on not judging anybody else. And so, in some instances, I was thinking about this, shame is not necessarily a bad thing. Because what is conviction of sin? Doesn't convict, when the Holy Spirit convicts you, doesn't he bring to you a sense of shame? So shame is not always a bad thing. In fact, I think sometimes we take it way too far. Don't we live in a shameless culture in America? Christians are being shamed for standing up for life, for instance, or for morality. We're shamed for Christian stand. And people that are doing stuff that the Bible and the Lord considers shameful are proudly standing up. So maybe we could use a little more shame in our culture than what we have. A little more social pressure. At least in the biblical ways. So conviction, if it's from the Lord, is a positive thing. It can motivate us to repent. Okay? But shame can also be used by the devil, by Satan. He can use shame to keep you from apologizing or talking to someone. And what you want to do is you want to just curl up within yourself. And you don't want to take care of a relationship with God or a relationship with someone else because you're ashamed of what you've done or what you've said. So shame can be a negative thing from the devil. Or it can be a conviction of the Holy Spirit, and you have to discern which is which. God never, ever, ever shames us and keeps us from reconciling. He never does that. If you feel like crawling up in a hole and you don't want to deal with the problem, that's probably not coming from God. The other thing about shame and guilt is it is a weak motivation. It is a motivation, okay? And it can be used at times positively. But it is a weak motivation. And you find out about that when you try to diet. You know, if you look at yourself in the mirror and you see that you're gaining weight, you feel, I'm ashamed of myself. I don't even fit into my clothes, right? I guess I just won't look at myself in the mirror anymore. So shame can lead to repentance, the conviction that you need to do something about your weight, about your diet. But it's not a real strong motivation for change, is it? Faith is the motivation for change, right? Hope is the motivation for change. And that's why, as Christians, we can't just repent, we also have to have faith. It takes both to see change in our lives. And so, if you want to have a spirit of giving, it comes not out of shame or guilt. That's not the most powerful spirit of giving or powerful motivation. It comes out of more positive motivations. Like if you see a need and you have compassion, you might be led to give. Or if you want to express your love for God, you give. Though that's the spirit of giving. There was a lady that I know, and I've used her as an example before, but she's a really powerful example. Her name is Connie. She's a single mom. And she was working a job and going to school and also taking care of her kids. She had three kids. Her husband had abandoned her. And I found out that she did not have any money at all for Christmas presents. And so our church gave, was really short of money, but we gave some money to her so that her parent, her kids could have some Christmas presents. We didn't make a big deal of it. Probably no, hardly anybody knew about it. But I just said there's a need, and people gave, and we distributed, the treasure distributed the money for Christmas presents. I think it was about $300, which back in the day, 20 years ago, was not too much. That's, that she could buy Christmas presents for three kids with that. Our church got in financial difficulty, and I felt like the church was almost getting ready to, was going to have to close. We got in tremendous financial difficulty. It was a brand new church. We weren't very stable financially. And I remember one Sunday we closed the books, and we had, and our, the order that we would pay, we always had order of pay, is we'd pay our local bills first. And so we paid our mortgage and our, on the church and our bills first, and had nothing left over. Normally we do that. Well, this time we didn't even have any money to pay the rent on the facility we were using. And this is on Sunday. We had $2,000 that came in, and that all went to local bills first. And then the next thing up was our rent. And the rent was due on Wednesday, but we didn't have the $4,500 for the rent. Now the church is bringing in is bringing in maybe around $6,000 a month. But anyway, I'm not going to give the math of it, but we needed $4,500 by Wednesday, and we have no service, we have no offering for that to come in. That gal had inherited a house from her mother, and the difference between what the mortgage was and how much she inherited was $45,000, and she tithed the $45,000. She brought a check in for $4,500 on Wednesday morning.
That's awesome.
And it helped pay the mortgage on the church. That's the widow's mite. Who would think that the lady would, and this was in March, 3 months before we'd helped her have a few hundred dollars for Christmas presents, she brings a check in for $4,500. You know what? She brought it in with joy. She was so happy because she always wanted to give more. That's what it's, when it talks about in the scripture, deciding your heart. Don't be pressured from what anybody says, even a pastor. Don't be pressured from what anybody says. Don't be pressured from what you think other people are doing. This is between you and God. Decide in your heart. Ask the Lord what it is you should give. That's where the spirit of giving comes from. It comes from our relationship with the Lord. It comes from the heart. I'm going to read that scripture in Matthew. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy, where three thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. It's not about how much money you have, it's not how much treasure you have, but it's about where your heart is, where's your focus. If you focus on things, it's going to be hard to give. But if you focus on the Lord first, you will have a spirit of generosity, because God is the ultimate giver. And as His Spirit dwells within you, you have a spirit of compassion and love. And it's out of that that the spirit of giving comes. And when the spirit of giving comes from a proper motivation, God is pleased with you. It's out of your heart. That's a challenge for me. Sometimes I give because I look around and I see, well, everybody else is giving to this. I suppose I should too. But I'm trying to pray and let the Lord. And sometimes the Lord tells me more than what I think I should give. And sometimes the Lord says, okay, you need to give to this. You need to do this. Or, and it's not just money, but it's time and all the other things that are valuable to me. You need to give this person some time, Brock. You need to give them a call or whatever. You need to give this person some forgiveness. The spirit of giving comes from forgiving. It comes from compassion. It comes from love. It comes from our heart. It comes from our Heavenly Father. Now the worship team is going to lead us in a song. And what more appropriate way to finish this sermon? We're going to give an offering. And you go, Brock, I was going to give this offering because I felt like I had to, but now you told me I didn't need to, so I'm going to keep it up. just as you give, this is part of our worship. Give out of joy, love, and as you give with a prayer and thank the Lord for what he's done for you. I'll call the ushers up. And you can put prayer requests and so forth on your next step card and put them in the offering or give them to an usher after the service. And they'll take these and bring these to the office so we can pray. These are in the chairs in front of you. You always can fill out one of these if you need to. And we will remember you in prayer. Let's pray. Bless the offering. Our Heavenly Father, inspire in us. Lord, I first want to thank you for reviving our hearts, for a tremendous prophetic inspiration that Anna and Ramon gave us today, how you led them to speak from their heart, gave them courage to do that. It was a word for each one of us. I thank you for the people that gathered at this altar with concerns or thanksgiving that their prayers will be answered. I thank you for moving among the leaders and your people in your church, Lord Jesus. For all the people that have recently checked the Next Step card and said, I want to volunteer to help with something. I want to thank you for the spirit of giving that gave us a beautiful facility to worship you and ministries that reach out to our community. And Lord, bless this offering and bless us in our motivation and to give to you out of our love for what you've done for us and our compassion for others. In the name of Jesus, amen. Let me bless you with a blessing. Lord, inspire in your people a measure of giving that as we forgive and as we give of our time and our effort and our energies for you, that you would, Lord, we claim your blessing that you would give back to us in all kinds of ways and a tremendous overflow pressed down, shaken over, and overflowing. Bless your people. In your name we pray. Amen.